It's good to see everyone out this morning. We're glad you're here. Hope you're prepared to worship because that's why we've gathered. So let's stand together for our call to worship. Psalm 134 says, "Praise the Lord, all you servants of the Lord. Lift up your hands in the sanctuary and praise the Lord." We'll invite our deacons to come and light the candles to remind us of the presence of God. And as they come, let's sing "Victory in Jesus" and sing it like you mean it this morning. And to lead us while we pray.
Our Heavenly Father, Lord, once again, Lord, we're just so grateful to have an opportunity to come to your house and worship your name and sing your praises, Lord. And Lord, we're grateful to live in a country where we're free to do this as we choose, Lord, without fear of repercussions. And Lord, we just ask that your Holy Spirit be with us here this morning, Lord, and come into our hearts, Lord, and open those up so we might hear the message you'd have us hear. And Lord, we ask that you be with Brother Chris as he delivers your message. And these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, and you may be seated. Let's sing our worship hymn now. Number 238, "Breathe on Me."
Sunshine, fill it, it's in my heart.
our responsive reading this morning, we will be reading from the book of Romans, entitled The Witness of the People of God, Testimony. I am obligated both to Greeks and non-Greeks, both to the wise and the foolish.
I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile.
For in the gospel a righteousness from God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith.
Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship.
Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind.
Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, perfect will.
Our next hymn is 483, Footsteps of Jesus. Let's sing together. At this time, we'll ask our ushers to come as we receive our tithes and offerings. We're going to sing I'm Just a Child as they receive these tithes and offerings. Join in with me. Now, if we happen to get through it, we'll start over at the beginning, okay? So be ready, Bryce. It's not a very long song. Here we go. I'm just a child and I haven't got much, but whatever I have, I give it to you, Lord. I'm just a child and I haven't got much, but whatever I have, I give it all to you. I'm just a child and I haven't got much, but whatever I am, I give it to you, Lord. I'm just a child and I haven't got much, but whatever I am, I give it all to you. Now we know it. Let's start over at the beginning. What are you laughing about? You didn't know that? I've got records. We've sung this 7 times since I've been here. Here we go. I'm just a child and I haven't got much, but whatever I have, I give it to you, Lord. I'm just a child and I haven't got much, but whatever I have, I give it all to you. I'm just a child and I haven't got much, but whatever I am, I give it to you, Lord. I'm just a child and I haven't got much, but whatever I am, I give it all to you. Oh, that was wonderful. Let's stand together and worship as we present our tithes and offerings to the Lord. Sing with me the Gloria Patri. Glory be to the Father.
Glory be to the Father. We
bow for prayer. Brother Claude Carter, will you lead us while we pray?
Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity that thou hast given us to come to thy house and worship thee. Now be with us as we go into this service. Bless the one that brings the message. Bless his offering for the benefit of thy kingdom. These things we do ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, and you may be seated. Our prayer hymn this morning is Sweet Hour of Prayer. At the end of that hymn, Brother Tate Adams is going to come and lead us in our morning prayer. Our prayer response this morning will be When I Pray.
Just want to say a little bit before I read these is that sometimes we get in the habit of talking about missionaries and you know it's just part of the service and we really don't understand the importance of what these people really do. It's just not something that we're doing, guys. These missionaries go out and do what we're supposed to be doing right here in our local community, and that's going out and trying to reach people for Jesus Christ. And so when we read these things, it's just not some mundane thing that we're doing to add a little bit to the church service. It's our responsibility as Christians to try to reach out to people in this community. These people take on the job of going overseas and here in the States, do a tremendous job of trying to reach people for Christ. And the Bible tells us that we're all supposed to do the Great Commission. So just keep that in mind. And when we come up and read these missionary board moments, that you understand that there's a real importance of why we read these. And we need to keep these people in our prayers, because those that go overseas on the international board, they're putting their lives on the line. They have took God's word and they're willing to risk everything they have to go over and reach people for Christ. And you know, some of them die. They martyr themselves for the Lord. You know, and we're over here in a country where we have all these freedoms, and we're not willing to even step out of our comfort zone and witness to people when we have the opportunity. And so, you know, sometimes I think when I come up here and I'm reading these, you know, are we really paying attention? And I just want us to understand that these people are so important, and that when they go out, you know, they're doing something really important, and we need to remember that. So as I read these today, and from now on when other people come up here and read them, keep that in mind, how important these people are. And then, you know, I know it's hard, guys. I have a difficult time stepping out of my comfort zone and witnessing to people to Christ. And it scares me at times. I worry about the day that when judgment comes. We talked about this in Sunday school today, that when I stand before God, He's going to say, Tate, what have you done for me? How many people have you stepped out and asked, you know, do they know me? And I'm going to think, you know, no, it's not a job well done, because I'm 54 years old. And sometimes I feel like that, you know, I've wasted a lot of years of my life. And, you know, we've got to get out of the fear of talking to people about Jesus Christ. Guys, this country needs it so bad. Not just this country, but the whole world. And we see stuff going on. It really, you know, it breaks my heart. So we're here. Let's try to have the courage to do what we need to do as Christians. Let's get out of that comfort zone. You get an opportunity to talk to somebody this week about the Lord Jesus Christ, don't let that opportunity pass you by. I'm on my soapbox, Chris.
Sounds good. I'm going to pass the plate again when you're done.
So, but it's just been weighing on my heart lately. And I feel sometimes like I don't do enough. That, you know, we're all responsible for works in this church. And I fall short, just like everybody, you know, like all of us. And we're sinners, guys. We're never, ever going to be good enough. We're never. But we got a God that has covered us by grace. And we can go to that God and we can ask for forgiveness. But if you're not a Christian, you don't have that option. You know, so we need to spread the word as much as we can. And these people step out every day of their lives and go out there, and they're trying to reach people for the Lord Jesus Christ. So I'll step off my soapbox, and I'll go ahead and read these, and then we'll pray. Today's International Missionary Board is Ruth Kimball. She serves as an IMB missionary in Paraguay, working in the wings of a hospital reserved for terminally ill cancer and AIDS patients. How important is that? All right. Another one of the jobs, again, I'm almost preaching here.
It's all right, it sounds good.
But when we go to that nursing home ministry, and I don't go there all the time, I try to get there, but I miss it. But those that go, like Nina and Guy and Brenna, and I'm going to miss people, but several of us come up there, and we got lonely people that are in that nursing home that may not see, we may be the only contact that they have that week. We might not be, but we may be. And listen, when you see these people, that some of them even have dementia, but when they're singing and they can mouth every word that we're singing, it's quite amazing that somewhere in their life, God has stamped those songs in their heart, and that they can sit up there and sing those songs right along with us. So every ministry this church does has a true value to it. So I'm just saying, some of you, I realize work schedules, there's so much going on. But when you get the opportunity to step up and work for this church, don't pass it by. Because God's going to ask us one day, what? He's going to ask us, what have you done for me? And we've got to answer. So last one, and then I'll let Mr. Bailey get back up here and take over.
You're still supposed to pray after.
I know. Okay. Yes, I will. We will pray. So, North American Missionary Board, Paul Hunt, he serves as a church planter in Missouri, Montana, if I'm saying that right. His ministry focuses on those in the Northwest who are searching for truth, but many are skeptical of the church. Okay? So, as we go to prayer, just kind of keep in mind some of the things I've said. It's again, as a 54-year-old Christian, I don't know how long I've got left on this earth. And so all I can do is from this day forward do what? Try to improve what I haven't done in the last 54 years. So because at times I really feel like I have wasted so many opportunities. And I don't want to be the one that's standing before God and he asks me, what have I done for him? And sit there and say, hey, God, I haven't done anything for you. You know, but he's going to allow me to do what, guy? He's going to allow me to go into heaven because I'm covered by grace. And I don't deserve to be there. So, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you today, we just are so thankful for all that you do for us, dear Lord. And we just ask that you be with us and that your Holy Spirit dwell in us, dear Lord. We just ask that you continue to inspire us, teach us, and give us the courage to step out of our comfort zone, dear Lord, to go out and do your work like these missionaries do. We just ask that you be with this country and that we so bad need a leader, dear Lord, that has moral and ethical values that will lead this country in the right direction. We need moral and ethical value people in all positions of local government on up. We just ask that we have your help and then that we can turn back to you and be the country that we used to be, dear Lord, because we're falling way down. And we all can see it. As Christians, we see it. We battle it every day. And we just ask for that strength, dear Lord, that when we step out, that we have the courage, dear Lord, to talk to people about you. Give us this mission, dear Lord, to grow your church, dear Lord. Whether they come to this church or go to another church, it doesn't really matter. We just need to get them in church. So we ask that you work with us, that you continue to bless this church. This church does so many things, dear Lord, and it needs your blessing. It needs your help. And we just ask that everybody that's involved step up to the plate and help do your work, dear Lord. We say these things in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. This time we'll ask Matt to come share our announcement. As he comes, our choir, we can work your way back to their seats. And I need Samuel and Kendall. Are you both back there? Get up here. I put you to work this morning. And I am so glad you're following Tate, not me, because he sets the bar high. You're going to have a heck of a job.
Where he left off.
All right, keep going.
So Tate's got us ready to work now, so I'm going to tell you all the places you can do that. Of course, every Sunday night at 6 we're here, and every Wednesday night at 6 we're here for discipleship training and for prayer and Bible study. If you look on the right side of your bulletin on the inside, we do have some special events coming up. Tonight at 7:30 down at Current, Austin Anderson will be there to lead worship. And the WMU has an August item of the month for the Samaritan's Purse. It's a great ministry that sends gifts out to kids who may not know Jesus at all in other countries, and they give them a few presents and a few scriptures to try to get them on the right track. But for it's toothbrushes and toothpaste this month. Along with that, though, the WMU will not meet on September 14th, and they do not have a makeup date yet. So the WMU meeting for the 14th will not meet, and we'll announce the change of date later on. Some other events coming up in our community. We have fifth quarter, which is we go down to the youth center after the home football games. Last year we averaged 150-ish, 130, 130 to 140, 150 kids. Gives them a good safe place to go after the football games. We're there till midnight. If you want to get involved with that, we'd love to have your help. We've also been having some bigger numbers at E Club on Sunday afternoons. And they're getting to where they may need a couple of extra classes. So if God's telling you need to come down there and work with the kids, I'm sure they would love to have some help with lessons or games or just extra supervision. So that's, of course, every Sunday afternoon. And then we have the Community Relay for Life this Saturday. We'll also be at the Emmanuel Center and the surrounding streets around that. The praise and worship group for Current will be performing about 6 o'clock, so if you'd like to come listen to them, support Relay for Life, we'd appreciate all of it. And of course, keep our youth ministries always at the front of your prayers. Of course, you know, the future is going to be our youth. So whether it's Bible school or the e-club or youth groups or anything like that, always keep those in your thoughts and prayers. Anybody have any other announcements we need to make?
Well, let's stand together as we come to our praise songs. If you want to come up and help sing, we appreciate it. We've got some young people usually join us here. That... Oh, boy's excited.
Worthy is the Lamb, Lamb who was slain.
Say amen. You're going to sing that forever. That's right out of scripture. So you can be seated if you wish. If you want to stand, you can stand. Our next song is Come As You Are.
Sorrow that heaven can do.
Now, this is new, so, but you can pick it up quick, can't you?
Probably.
Left my fear by the side of the road. Here's me, won't let go. Fall to my knees as I lift my hands to pray. God, every reason to be here again. Father's love draws me in. And all my eyes want to see is a glimpse of you.
Good job, guys and gal. Stay right up here on the front seat, okay? Let's sit right down here on the front seat for just a minute. We'll do our children's message.
Come on up here. You gotta make a dramatic entrance, don't you? You gonna take that for me? All right. This one is entitled, To Whom Shall We Go? And you're going home, aren't you? Tomorrow?
The day after tomorrow.
Day after tomorrow. Well, did you call and see if you could just stay forever? I think there's somebody over there would like for you to, so. To whom shall we go? And what's your name?
Timothy.
Timothy. Nice to meet you, Timothy. Well, I'm on there now. Timothy, who did you come with today? Was it Shay?
Walker.
Walker's mom. You should say Walker, not Walker's mom. One time Jesus said something that really scared people a whole lot. I mean, they really got scared. He said something about, if you really want to follow me and if you really want to make it to heaven, you have got to do some stuff that's really scary, including, he said, eat my flesh and drink my blood. Now, he was talking about what? The Lord's Supper, right? Yeah, but people didn't understand, and some of them said, we're out. That's it. We've been following you, Jesus. You've been feeding us. You've been doing some really cool stuff, but that's enough. We're done. And then he looked over, and there were still some apostles. And Jesus said, you're not going to leave. And they said, well, where else can we go? Because you're the answer. And that's what it says on this sheet. To whom shall we go? Where do we go for the most important thing of all? To live with God forever. Where do we go? Who do we turn to? To Jesus. Yeah. Let's pray about that, okay? Thank you, God, so much for sending Jesus. Thank you for what he has done for us. And that's my prayer, that these children never, ever forget that he is the way. And there's nowhere else to go. Bless them, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Good job, guys. Going back to your seats. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Psalm 84. Psalm 84. And I'm going to remove my tether here. Yeah. Yeah, so you can go downstairs then and miss this wonderful sermon. Psalm 84 is where we are, and anybody using the Pew Bible can tell me what page it's on? 922. Well, let's stand together as we read from God's Word. There's some words in this psalm that we're going to read this morning. If you go to current, you're going to recognize some of the phrases. There's two or three songs that we sing down there that that use this psalm as a basis. So, how lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty. My soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may have her young, a place near your altar. O Lord Almighty, my King and my God. Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you. Blessed are those whose strength is in you, who have set their hearts on pilgrimage. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. The autumn rains also cover it with pools. They go from strength to strength till each appears before God in Zion. Hear my prayer, O Lord God Almighty. Listen to me, O God of Jacob. Look upon our shield, O God. Look with favor on your anointed one. Better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those whose walk is blameless. O Lord Almighty, blessed is the man who trusts in you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be unto God. Thank you for your word, Father. Now speak to our hearts through your Holy Spirit, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, and you may be seated. School is back in session full scale now. It's been, what, 2 weeks almost? Are we in the routine? Okay. Do you smell fall in the air, the cooler mornings? I find it a little depressing. I don't like fall coming. It just reminds me that I'm another year older. This Friday night we have fifth quarter. When that happens, it'll really sink in that another year has passed. I hope I survive it. Break is over for our community. It's time to get back to work, right? Life is going on.
And it's during this time that we need to really pause and think for a minute. As we get really busy, as the community as a whole gets really busy, that we not get to the place where we are aware or unaware of God. We need to live the Christian life during this busy time, not just get caught up in the work and the things we've got to do and leave God behind, okay? Psalm 84 is really wonderful because it gives us some great insight on what our Christian life should really be about, okay? And some of the issues in here I think will speak to all of us. First of all, we're going to talk this morning about living as a Christian means living in the presence of God. That's huge alone. Really, what we could do is stop right there and say, if you're going to be a Christian, you're going to live with a sense of the presence of God. And we all should stop and pray and think about who we are and what we're doing and whether the presence of God is real in us or not. And then we're going to talk about the journey of life that we take as Christians, and we're going to talk about the power of God in us. So that's our message this morning. Tate did a good job. I started an invitation hymn at the end of his thing. It was good. I don't know what he's been drinking, but I hope you all get a bottle of it because it's good. I don't mean drinking as in alcohol. What are you laughing about? I mean what he's got going in him is good. That's the way it should be. I appreciate what he had to say. He was spot on. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
You should have said it a while ago. I don't know why you didn't. So, how lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty. This is where preachers get up and say, okay, so this means you should be in church.
Amen.
One. My soul yearns, even faints for the courts of the Lord. And it's true, we should be in church. Not much sense in me hollering that right now because you're all in church, right? But it means something deeper than that too for Christians, because in their culture there was the temple. They hadn't even have synagogues at this point. There was just the temple. And this was the place where they could go and experience the presence of God. People traveled for miles to go to the temple, which is a big deal for us. You can get in your car and travel in an hour. Why did it take them forever to get there? But when they walked into this temple, they knew God was there, and it was beautiful to them. That's why he says, it's how lovely is your dwelling place. And he yearned for it, verse 2. They desired it greatly. And when they were there, it was about praise. If you go down to verse 4, blessed are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you. So this was the attitude of the people. I wish it was that way today for Christians. God's church is beautiful, and I long to be there. And when I'm there, all I can do is praise God. That would be great. But let's talk about a deeper issue. And that is, as a Christian, the temple of God is here within you. Okay? And there should be in us this wonderful desire to experience God, just like these people wanted to experience God at the temple. We should yearn for an experience with the Holy Spirit. So much so that when it hits you, you praise. Now, that's where we're supposed to be. This is the defining quality of who we are, okay? This is what makes you a Christian. Somebody who has Christ in you, God in you, the Holy Spirit in you. That's what makes you a Christian. Not the relationships or your jobs or your interests. Those are things that pull you away from God. This is what makes you a Christian. Someone who has the Spirit of God in them because they've accepted Christ. They've received forgiveness. They're children of God. This should be the defining motivation for what we do. Why you do what you do is because God is in you. Not because you got bills to pay. Not because you have things you like to do. This should be what motivates you more than anything else. Experiencing God. And it should be so strong that you cannot help but praise. This should be the things, this should be the lens, this should be the filter that you look at everything in your life. Is God in me? God in me. Is that important? But is it? What is our filter? What is our lens? How is it that we look at the world? Do we look at the world like people who have God in them, or do we look at the world like everyone else? There was a story in the news this week about a family in at a hotel in the Niagara Falls in Canada, the Canadian side. They had called for maintenance. Maintenance come up to unlock the safe in the room. You know what they'd locked in their safe? Their baby. Oh, yeah. Maintenance came in, took them a half hour. The baby was crying, but it was okay. Got the baby out. The family loaded up and hightailed it out of there before the police got there. The police got there. They had a description of the van, the license number. It was on the news, the local news. They were searching for it. They were mad. And they were Americans too, you know. That helped. But you know what really happened? They had two children, a toddler and an infant. And when they weren't looking, the toddler had locked the baby in the safe. Now that changes the whole story, doesn't it? Because our immediate reaction was, oh, these awful parents, we should string them up. They interviewed people, like sort of the man on the street interviews, while they were searching for it, and that's what people were saying. They need to take these parents and lock them in a safe, you know. But the real story was an accident. But the lens kicked in, the way we view things. Our knee-jerk reaction took over. As Christians, the knee-jerk reaction in us should be, what does God move us to feel and think? That's our lens. That's our filter for all the experiences we have. You need to live your life aware of and responding to the presence of God. I'm going to ask you a tough question. Don't answer out loud, but you really need to answer this to yourself. Does the awareness of God in you really mean anything? Is there any impact at all by the fact that God's in you? Has it changed you at all? And maybe another important question would be, are you willing to be completely upended and your life completely torn apart by allowing God in and God to take control? There is a reason why when Jesus sat with Nicodemus in John 3, he says, if you want to become a true follower of God, you have to be what? Born again. Start all over. Because what you are is not what God wants. You got to start from scratch. You got to become somebody completely new. You got to be what Paul called a new creation. You've got to be upended and changed. Does the presence of God mean anything to you? Well, now, as the psalmist was writing about the wonderful presence of God, he talked about the journey that people back then had to take. Verse 5 says, blessed are those whose strength is in you, who have set their hearts on pilgrimage. In other words, blessed are those who are willing to make the journey to just be with you. And here's the question we have to talk about this morning, is what is the journey for us? Is ours a journey of yearning and seeking God? What is our journey? Now, we have this place called the Valley of Baca. A little confusing. We don't know exactly what it means. The word itself means weeping. Some want to say, hey, this is not a literal place, it's a symbolic place. Others point to the desert place that some called Baca. The Muslims point out that Baca later became Mecca. That's not true, as if to justify their pilgrimage to Mecca, like it had always taken place, it was always God's plan. Whatever the specific meaning is, you can understand what he's saying, though. To seek God is a journey through a place that is a desert, sad, weeping journey. It can be tough. But he says in verse 5, they're blessed. And in verse 6, that the weeping, the desert place, becomes places of pools. And God gives strength. In other words, the journey to see God and experience God in your life may be a tough one, but on that journey there is blessing from God, there is strength from God, and there is joy from God. And if we're not living our lives seeking the blessing and the strength and the joy that God gives as we make this pilgrimage to experience the presence of God, we are shutting God out. How much has God been shut out of your life? Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. In other words, he's seeking an experience with you. Just open the door. How many times have we left the door shut? We haven't made the journey to be with God. And what have we done to ourselves? I'm only 52, Tate. I'm not 54. But I've probably wasted the same number of years you have. What have I shut myself out of by not relishing the joy and the strength and the blessing that comes by experiencing God and doing His will? But I guess most importantly, when we get to the place where we are not experiencing the blessing and the strength and the joy of God, we've lost the purpose that God created us with. Listen, the world is getting tougher. Our community is getting tougher. Our nation is getting tougher. It's harder and harder to be who we're supposed to be, but we've got to be stronger and stronger. And the scripture teaches us that if we make that pilgrimage, that journey for the presence of God, there is blessing, strength, and joy. There's a new study just released, and some of you probably heard about this. It's not good news, especially as school starts back, that lice now have developed stronger immunities. Have you seen that? It's going to be tougher to kill. All the teachers said, yeah, I saw that. I saw the study. There's a map, and some of the states were colored in pink, and some of them were in green. The pink states have the stronger lice. Guess what color we were? We're pink, yeah. Good news, we're pink. We've got the tougher strain of lice. But doctors can still take care of the problem. It's just harder. They warned us against using things like olive oil and mayonnaise. They say they don't really work. I can't imagine what a person smells like 2 days after a head full of mayonnaise and olive oil, can you? Yeah. Might be better to have the lice. Yeah. The only real home remedy that works for head lice is to shave your head. Yeah. And some of you probably grew up in a time when children came to school with shaved heads, you knew why their heads were shaved. Yeah. But that's just like life. Everything that's tough and difficult out there gets tougher and tougher. It's not just the lice that have learned to be tougher and harder to get rid of. Sin's the same way. You don't think the devil's learned anything over the last centuries or so, how to get tougher? You don't think sin has gotten tougher? More and more we need the blessing and the strength and the joy that God gives. Are you on that journey? Well, let's go to the scripture one more time. Verses 8 through 12. I want you to look at verse 9 especially. See, verses 8 through 12, it looks like he's shifting gears because he's talking about it's wonderful to be in God's house, and then in the next set of verses about how wonderful it is that a people are making this journey to be there. Then all of a sudden he says, hear my prayer, God, and look out for your anointed one, the king. Just like, well, what's that all about? Well, the word that's translated as anointed one is, in Hebrew, is Messiah. Sounds a whole lot like Messiah, doesn't it? That's what the Messiah is. He's the anointed one. But here's the hope that he's praying for as he thinks about the people making the pilgrimage. Number one, he's praying for his king. Now think about that. Why would he be praying for the king? Because the king was the ruler. He was the direction. He was the purpose of the nation. And so what he's praying for in our words today is, Lord, it's wonderful to be in your presence. I pray for those who are seeking you, and now as this journey has begun, I pray that the purpose and the direction of our people would rest in your hands. I pray for those who are blameless in verse 11. I pray for those who trust in you in verse 12. So let's talk about those three things: the purpose, the behavior, and the trust. What is the purpose of a Christian? Is it to get to heaven? Is it to glorify God? Is it to build the kingdom? The answer is yes. It's all those things. What about our behavior? What is it that God seeks from us? Is it that we be moral people? Is it that we be compassionate people? Is it that we be people who follow Christ? Well, the answer to that is yes, to all of them. And that last verse, those who trust in you, what does that mean to trust? Does it mean they have the right understanding about doctrine or morality or conscience? Yes. Is it people who trust God by living the life that God calls them to live? Yes. This is our hope. That our purpose, that our behavior, that our trust is focused on Christ. That we truly follow Him. You know what the word empathy means, don't you? Empathy means to feel what someone else feels. And as Christians, what we should be endeavoring to do is to have empathy, in a strange way, for Christ, to try to feel as Christ feels, to make that connection so that our purpose and our behavior and our trust reflects Christ. There was a new research study released recently, I think it was Baylor, talking about psychopaths. You know what a psychopath is, don't you? Don't name names, just say you know, okay? And they found a curious thing about psychopaths, a way that you can, a hint that maybe someone's a psychopath. And you can take this with you this week, okay? This is practical stuff you can use, okay? Psychopath is someone who does not have the ability to empathize. They cannot feel what anybody else feels. That's one of the things. They're also, you know, they're also narcissistic and several other things. But one of the key issues about a psychopath is they cannot feel for others or what others feel. And they discovered something interesting. There is a behavior that we do that if I were to do it right now, several of you would do it right back, and you can't help it. And it's not smile. It's not smile. It's yawn. Do you do that? When somebody yawns, everybody starts yawning? They did a study and they found out that psychopaths tend not to yawn back. Isn't that interesting? Teacher's going to be all week. They're going to go into class. Hello, class. And just look, and let's see, who's the psychopath out there? Another week or so, you probably have it figured out anyway, right? Yeah. We need to have this empathy relationship with Christ, where if Christ would smile, we would smile. If he would love, we would love. If he would give, we would give. That what he does, we emulate. We do it right back. We follow deeply what he would do. That's really hoping. That's really trusting God. It's corny and hokey to say, what would Jesus do at everything? But really, that's where we need to be. What would Jesus do? Or what would he not do? Or what would he think? What would he feel? Help me be that. Here's the message this morning. We are supposed to be a people who live with a sense of God's presence, and that presence blesses us with strength and joy, and that life becomes about hope for God's direction. A life lives reflecting Christ, feeling Christ, and doing what Christ would do, fully trusting him. Examine your heart this morning. Are you the Christian you're supposed to be? Are there changes you need to make? Because let me tell you something. You're broken, every one of you. We all are. But God can make you who you need to be. You've just got to yield yourself to him. Our invitation hymn this morning is 307, Just As I Am. And it asks you the same question. Will you present yourself to God just as you are, giving yourself to him? Stand together as we sing. If you have a prayer need or a concern or a decision to make or one to share, come and we'll be here to pray with you. Stand together as we sing.
But that
I thank you for your kind attention, and I lift up those who've come for prayer this morning and ask that you pray for them and the convictions in their heart. This time we'll ask our deacons to come as we conclude our time of worship. Now to him who is able to establish you in accordance with a gospel message about Jesus Christ, to the only wise God, be glory forever through Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's bow for our closing prayer. Brother Tate, will you lead us?
Dear Heavenly Father, we are just so gracious, dear Lord, to be able to be in your house and to sing and worship you. We are so thankful for Brother Bailey, dear Lord, that he's the type of leader that can lead and guide us and inspire us, along with you, dear Lord, to do what this church needs to do. We just ask now that you be with us and be with us through this week. And if we have the opportunity, dear Lord, to talk to somebody about you, that we will take that opportunity. Just continue to encourage us, dear Lord, and help us to run the race all the way to the end. And be with us now as we leave this church. And we pray for safe travels. And we pray that we will be back at the next appointed time. We say these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Parting hymn this morning is Go Now in Peace. We're going to sing it in just a second. I want to ask you to please be in prayer for E-Club. It's at 4 o'clock today. We have so many children who come there who have no church home at all, no experience with church. They don't go to church anywhere ever. This is the only church they have. So be in prayer for that. Discipleship training tonight is at 6. We're going to be in Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 through 34. Current worship is 7:30. When I put this in the bulletin, I didn't get it all in because we had some things out there hanging. But Austin is going to be there to be lead worshiping. Carrie Jo's going to sing tonight, special music. And Anthony Anderson is going to be there doing devotion. I don't remember what all made it in the bulletin, but we do the bulletin. Children's choir practice at 3:30. I'm so sorry. Thank you for reminding me. And Samuel and Kendall, are you all doing anything today at 3:30? Children's choir? You going to come up? Don't know, do you? Okay. Put the pressure on him. Make him come. Okay. Because, I mean, obviously they like to sing. Fifth quarter is this Friday. Be in prayer for us. Brethren, pray for us. Yeah. So sing with me.
Go now in peace. Go now in peace. May the love of God surround you everywhere, everywhere you may go.
Okay, men, here we go.
Go now in peace, go now in peace. May the love of God surround you everywhere, everywhere.